fire glows warmly in the grate. Your chair is comfortable. You are at ease, relaxed. Nothing can disturb you, can it? After all, it's an everyday world. No undue ripples on the tranquil waters of your life. Yet the day must draw to a close, and night is as inevitable as death. But you are safe. Of that you are certain. You are safe. Aren't you? You did lock the door. Latch the windows. Didn't you? Yes. You are safe. And your will is strong. There is no room for superstition in your mind. Is there? Is there? Don't be too sure. Soon your fingers may itch to shut off the sounds you hear. Your throat tighten. The thudding of your heart become a mallet, driving a blood-red stake through to your soul. Your room, your comfortable home, become a cold, dank crypt. Within, the hammer house of horror. Ghost-like shadow that waits. A shrouded thing that pulsates with malignant evil. The name of that ghost is fear. Fear is born of the devil. It has no beginning, no end. It is eternal. Omnipotent. Fear is at your side as you listen to a half-heard sound. It is here, a finger touch away. It is always behind you, especially when you are alone. Substance to fear are the legends that surround it. The most dreaded one of all was conceived in a nightmare. It rose from the very bowels of hell. The Prince of Chaos, master of the undead, ruler of the damned, lord of the vampiric hordes, Count Dracula.
remote area of Transylvania, beyond the plains of Maros and the slopes of Gorgheni, there is a narrow road which winds through the dark and misty forests lying across the foothills of the Wallachian Alps. There are no milestones along here, no signposts to point the way. Some believe that it is a road without end. Others, that it disappears amidst the swirling fogs that mantle the woods. But there are a few who will tell you in hushed tones that it leads to Castle Dracula. And they will swear that at dead of night, four horses, pulling behind them a hearse, may be seen thundering along that road. Gleaming horses, nostrils flaring, hooves pounding, but no coachman at the reins. And inside, there is only a coffin. Towards the end of the last century, a coach travelling between Vaida and Maros became lost in the yellow fog that haunts the place. As the night drew on, the coachman found that he had somehow strayed onto that narrow, twisting road. Inside were two passengers, a young man and his radiant bride-to-be, journeying to Gorgheni, there to be married next morning. The track was rock-strewn and deeply rutted, and before long, one of the rear wheels came spinning off. As the coachman and the young man inspected the damage, the girl stepped to the side of the road, for she had seen the dull glimmer of a watery light through the curtain of trees. She moved slowly towards it, thinking it might come from a woodman's cottage. Before her was the grey bulk of a silent, towering castle. Windows stared down like eyeless sockets, dead, hollow, sightless. The dim light was coming from a doorway, beckoning, drawing her in. The hall was vaulted like a lofty crypt, and at the far end was a wide, winding stairway, guarded at its foot by two stone pillars. It was not the gloom of the place that sent her shivering, dread clutching at her heart. It was the atmosphere, the scent of death that pervaded the damp air, a sour smell of decay. It clung to the floor and the walls. Upon the stairs appeared the tall, gaunt figure of a man. His eyes were piercing and deep. The girl turned as the man looked beyond her to the open door. She saw her fiancé standing at the entrance. He told her that the coach was badly damaged. They could go no further that night. And then the gaunt man spoke. His voice was soft and courteous. He introduced himself to them as Count Dracula and welcomed them to his home. He would be honored if they would stay the night as his guests. Two rooms would be prepared. The young couple accepted the invitation. He offered them food. As they ate, they heard storm gathering. The room chosen for the girl was full of shadows. Sleep eluded her. She turned her thoughts to the next day, the day of her wedding. She heard the footsteps approaching. She turned to greet her young lover. But her warm smile froze on her lips. It was Dracula. As he came closer, she could feel cold paralysis grip her body, and terror swept over her. His hands reached for her, and his lips opened, revealing his teeth, his sharp teeth. The smooth, pure line of her neck was bare. His breath was sweet with the stench of the grave. His face loomed down. Another room, some distance away, it was perhaps the cry of a wolf that brought the girl's fiancé out from the depths of his sleep. He hurried down toward the vaulted hallway below. There, in the doorway, stood the coachman. As he lurched forward, the young man could see that his whole body was rent and bloody, his face contorted with horror and pain. The man stared down at the body in disbelief. Surely it must have been the wolves from the forest that had attacked him. No mortal being could have torn him in that way. then he saw her, his bride-to-be, standing at the far end of the great hall. Her hands, her body, her mouth splashed with blood. He ran towards her, but she was gone. Below him were narrow steps leading down into blackness. Mausoleum. In the center, lit by two candles, was an open coffin. Beside the coffin, in an attitude of deep devotion, stood the woman he loved. She smiled, a smile of adoration and passion. As she gazed upon the man lying in the open casket, as she looked upon Dracula, suddenly the young man recalled the legend of the undead, the vampire. He knew that the light of day destroyed him, and that a wooden stake driven into his heart would kill him and send his soul to eternal damnation. Among the cluttered debris in the vault, he found a length of wood and a slab of stone. They would have to serve. He moved swiftly to the casket. He placed the stake upon the vampire's chest. The woman gasped as he lifted the stone and brought it down. Monster's mouth stretched wide, and then the body began to age. The skin rotted away, the bones shone yellow in dull light, and the flesh of Dracula turned to dust. He staggered back from the obscene and awful sight as a pale shaft of morning light cut through the gloom of the vault, bathing the body of his young and radiant love. Then, the final horror. Seared and blasted by the dawn. Her last scream of torment would haunt him all the days of his life.
someone will find that casket in the cellars of Castle Dracula. And someone will surely remove the stake that is buried in the mound of graying dust within that coffin. When they do, the vampire will walk again.